Good evening, everyone. Before I actually get started, two quick announcements. I'll be talking about aging in the sense that behavioral or physiological changes occur in an individual with ongoing chronological time. So not just the adding of years to your CV, but also changes that happen within you as years go by. And the second one is, I would like to keep this informal if possible, so if any point I'm unclear or confuse you or you have any question, just grab my attention, interrupt me, and we want this to be a dialogue if possible. Okay, so the title is Aging in Cichlids, and I'll try to explain to you why I study that, where I study it, and how I study it. And the first question, though, why would anybody study aging in cichlids, was something that never occurred to me might be tricky to answer, but I explained to a friend of mine what I was doing, and he said, why would you study aging in the first place? Everybody's doing it without doing anything about it, and nobody likes it, so why would you have a closer look? And I struggled to answer this kind of challenge, and I came up with something that eventually convinced him, which I would call the socioeconomic answers to the question, why to study aging. So if we look at current human populations, what we see is a general increase in lifespan. So this is data from the World Bank. It's freely available. They have clever mathematicians and statisticians that for every year kind of calculate what the average life expectancy of a baby born in that year is in a given country. And this is data for the UK, and what we see is that over the last about 5 decades, both men and women in the UK, and then the average between them, was raised by about 1 decade of life expectancy. So what this means is that an ever larger number of people will have to struggle with diseases that are age-related, like cancer or cardiovascular diseases, that the way that we organize pensions currently might not be sustainable if everybody lives ever longer and longer and longer, and all of these things. And my friend said, okay, these are all good reasons to look at aging, but you can solve none of these. You're just an evolutionary biologist, so why would you get involved? And that brings me to that second part of answers to the question, which I would call the bioscience answers to this, and these revolve around the question which genes are involved in aging patterns, is immortality something that could ever be achieved, and how does this all fit in with evolutionary theory? And what I think would be ideal is if we had kind of a feedback between these two worlds where biosciences inform socioeconomic decision making and where socioeconomic problems flag up in which direction bioscientific research could go. The biosciences have dealt with this question of aging for a while, and basically two great fields have emerged that deal with this and that deal with the question of aging in different ways. One is this branch of how questions, so how do we age, what are the genes involved in aging, what are the metabolic pathways underlying, how do metabolic pathways change over time, or metabolic circuits, basically. And the other one is this evolutionary question of why has aging ever evolved? Why, if it seems so detrimental to us, is it still around? And people interested in these two questions work typically on different systems. So the people that ask the how questions work on model systems like Drosophila or yeast, where we have great tools to knock on or knock out certain genes, where we know a lot about their metabolism, etc. And then the why people typically work on species for which we have a lot of long-term data to look at differences in aging patterns within a population, for example. And these ones are kind of closer to my own heart, these why questions, because for me, this very general question of why age at all is kind of paradoxical. A paradox if we assume that evolutionary theory in general is true, which proposes that natural selection should favor those organisms that more successfully produce offspring that then themselves go on to more successfully reproduce, etc., etc. And one, from an engineering point of view, easy solution to this would be to just live and reproduce for longer periods of time. And our very human-centered world, we would always say this is simply not possible. Decay over time and death are inevitable consequences of life. But if we look at the tree of life, that is actually not necessarily true. So you don't have to look at these graphs in great detail, but what they are going to show or illustrate is the fact that what we typically understand as aging is an organism matures over here, and then for a long time it performs reasonably well, and then age kicks in and cancer and all types of bad things happen, and individuals die off. This is what actually happens in our populations. But if we look at other species, like these land tortoises, they have exactly the inverse pattern. So for them, after maturing, they are still small, they are dying of all kinds of things, not necessarily extrinsic causes, but also intrinsic causes. But once they've reached a certain age, these individuals basically live on forever. You might remember the story of Lonesome George, that one last tortoise who lived forever and ever after everybody else of his species had died already. And I think he died like 4 years ago or something. Anyways, took him a while of being Lonesome George. And then maybe even more interestingly, there's organisms like Hydra over here that seem to have a very stable rate of mortality, irrespective of age. And when kept under lab conditions, is actually turning into something as close to immortality as we've ever observed, because they can recycle through kind of juvenile stages. So for me, the key question then is, why do organisms age at different rates? And what can we learn from those that have patterns that we find desirable? Maybe not everybody's in favor of immortality, but probably everybody's in favor of a healthy maximum lifespan. And I think that what we need to do is use comparative approaches where we compare different species or different individuals that suffer from aging differently. We ask them how they deal with aging, and we ask them why they age at different rates, and then this may feed back on these socioeconomic problems that I flagged up in the beginning. And the question is, what do we compare with what? Do we take Drosophila and compare what we've observed there with sheep straight away? Do we just focus on one species and do everything in that? Or do we stay with model organisms and just compare things we've learned from those? And what I would claim is that in addition to all these approaches that already exist, what would be nice if we had a taxonomically closed group of animals in which we can both study these how and why questions about aging, and which are as close to humans as possible. So Drosophila, less good compared to mice, but maybe even better, you've all guessed it, cichlid fishes. Vertebrates, we've all been fish at some point, at least under the microscope. I liked these guys forever, and I found aging interesting, and here we are, basically. Let me tell you a little more about them so that maybe they're not just fish for you, but also to some degree interesting. They are kind of the picture book example of evolutionary biology happening in front of our eyes, if we so want. So they are very famous among evolutionary biologists for their rapid rate of speciation. We can look at species flock in, for example, Lake Victoria, which we know that it has been completely dry for the last time about 40,000 years ago, and then before we introduced other species. In these 40,000 years, from probably one ancestor, 1,000 species of these fish evolved in that lake, very, very quickly, compared to all other types of vertebrate evolution that we know about. The second interesting thing is that they show what is known as convergent evolution. So if you look at this poster here, you were asked to group these fish, what you might come up with is that these are five groups, each of them comprised of two individuals that look kind of similar. But if you were to look at their taxonomic relatedness, what you would find is that all these guys on this side are more closely related to one another than to any of these guys over here. So all of these are brother and sister species, and all of these are brother and sister species, and despite looking very similar, they are genetically very different. So it's a different genetic architecture arriving at a very similar phenotype. This is what is meant by convergent evolution. As you see, they are ecologically diverse, so we have species that only feed on invertebrates and mollusks, and they build these big lipped mouths with which they suck stuff out of crevices in rocks. And then we have species that swim in the open water and just feed on other types of small fish and everything in between, basically. And another good thing about them is that they are of economic importance. So in the countries where they actually occur, they are fished and eaten to a large scale. And the aquarium trade is something that brings in quite a bit of money into those countries where these fish occur. And I study these guys in Lake Tanganyika, which we see here. I don't know how good your geography of Africa is. But basically, all of this is the Democratic Republic of Congo. All of this is Tanzania. This is a look from above. So again, Democratic Republic of Congo, Tanzania, and Burundi and Zambia are the four countries that share the coasts of Lake Tanganyika. We are down here in Africa. There's red dots to help you, because this is actually the area where I'm working. The very southern tip of this lake, highlighted in all of these. Couple of facts about Lake Tanganyika. It's the second largest lake in the world with regards to body of water volume. It's the second deepest lake in the world, with about 1.5 kilometers at its deepest point. It's one of the ancient lakes in the world, so it was probably formed about 12 million years ago. And it is very rich in fish species. So about 300 different species of fish, most of which only occur in the lake. Many of which only occur in certain small areas of the lake, live in there, and 200 of these are cichlids. And in the area where Lake Tanganyika lies, it's an important source of protein for the local populations. You might have heard of tilapia, so a certain type of tilapia lives here. There's aqua farming in Lake Tanganyika as well, but there's also large-scale harvesting of wild fish. And it's an important source of fresh water in the area as well. So of general interest, I would claim, to people. The cichlids that I have a look at range in size, adult size between 3 to 80 centimeters. So yeah, quite the range. They feed on all kinds of things, as I alluded to earlier. So we have obligate vegetarians, we have obligate carnivores, and we have everything in between. We observe various types of mating systems where we observe actual biparental care, where fish stay together for various breeding rounds of breeding, and males and females are faithful to one another. We observe cases where females desert males immediately after laying their eggs, and the other way around, so the battle of the sexes is going on in these guys quite a bit. And importantly, all of these are more closely related to one another, taxonomically speaking, than to any fish outside of the lake. For this question of aging, the interesting part is probably that they live between a few years, even if kept under lab conditions, up to several decades. Fish of comparable size, some of them die after 2 years of all kinds of diseases that they get, others live for 15 years happily and grow and grow and grow. We'll soon have whole genome sequences of all of these fish. I'll talk about that briefly later. They have been established as organisms that field and lab studies are being done on, and I'll highlight a bit of that later on. And there's a broad interest in these fish from all kinds of, all areas of biology, basically. So they are a great system to collaborate with people who have expertise that I completely lack. Another important point. So the scope of the current project, which I'm doing here, is that I'll try and find and identify correlates of age in these fish. Because unlike humans, they don't come with a birth certificate, typically. So whatever I observe in the field, I have no idea how old the fish really are. So one of the approaches that we'll talk about briefly is that I'll look at their methylation patterns. In their fins, actually, to see whether there's a signal in there that correlates with chronological age. And I've taken various morphological measures to see whether certain types of morphological changes occur with age. And once these markers are there, then the idea would be to determine the age structure of different species and populations of different species, to then highlight and find ecological traits that correlate with different forms of aging patterns and different pace of life. This methylation work is done by Eric Miska and Grégoire Vernaz from the Goerden Institute here. And just very briefly, I'm not an expert in this at all, but in humans, what we can do now is we take a blood sample, we look at the methylation pattern at three distinct loci, and with certain statistical tools, we can age a human plus minus 5 years, just based on a single blood sample, not knowing anything else about the person. Ideally, we would get to something more accurate than plus minus 5 years, because many of these fish don't live 5 years. But if we scale it to the about 120 maximum age of humans, that we would be talking a couple of months accuracy. And that would be good enough for the things that I'm trying to do currently, at least. So what we are currently doing is we have fish that came with a birth certificate in the lab where I did my PhD in Bern in Switzerland. I've just been there 2 weeks ago or something. I've taken tissue samples from several of them. I've brought them here, and Eric and Grégoire, who are currently in Malawi, will be returning next week to then talk to me about how we approach these things, and we'll actually get a first couple of pilot tests, basically, to see whether this works. What I've also done while I was in the field last winter was that I've already taken samples in the field from populations that I revisit. You might not notice, but I'll highlight it here. These two guys, these triangles, this is fin tissue that I cut off underwater. So I caught the fish, I cut off a bit of its fin, I transfer it into alcohol, I release the fish, and hopefully I'll find these guys again eventually, and then I'll have repeated measures of the same individual at given time points to see whether a methylation has a pattern or has a signal of age in there. The other thing that I've done was to look at their morphology. So I've taken the same types of measurements on all kinds of species in several different populations, fish of several of a certain range of sizes that were available to me. Basically, what I've done, I've created a triangle for the head and then boxes of undefined shape for their body and their tail. And what you might notice, this guy is about 6 centimeters, this guy is about 8 centimeters, I think. And the idea is that what I'll do is I'll get the surface areas here, basically, and then I'll overlay them and I'll scale them to the same maximum size, and then I'll see whether they're different or not. These two guys are not. So whether this means they're both regular adults or whether they are just in the same age class, and the differences in size that we observe are based on the population that they come from. This is all stuff that has to be verified with these molecular clocks that we'll hopefully get. But the idea is that we'll get a chronological clock that actually measures chronological time with the methylation patterns, and that with the morphology we'll get something like a biological clock to see whether fish enter puberty always in the same shape and at the same time, or whether that is different between different populations of the same species. What I'm currently doing also, because I collect all of this data in the field, is that that will allow me to determine the age structure of different populations, of different species, and then I'll have a look at the ecological traits that co-vary with certain types of aging. So what I've done here is all of these pairs are the same species. You might see from the different colors on them, and then these things light up, and you know whether you've seen the fish before or not. And with this data, I'll be able to look at survival rates of different size and or age classes to measure their growth between field seasons, and to get an estimate of fitness based on whether they were breeding or not, whether they were territorial or not, etc. I'll, as I said several times before, I'm simultaneously collecting all of these ecological traits, basically. So populations look very different depending on where you dive in the lake. Fish have very different ecologies, so to say. So this is an obligate algae grazer. So these fish do nothing all day long but scrape algae off of stones. They have specialized lips and jaws for this. And this guy would try to eat the other guy, has a completely different ecology, basically. And the idea is that I'll compare these data that I collect based on between species in the same population or in the same spot, and then across species and across various populations. I'm collecting data on predation risk and general ecosystem composition or species composition in the area. I'm measuring abiotic factors like whether these snail shells are available, which are a habitat to a lot of these smaller species, or whether algae grazing is possible or not. I have several plots that are in protected areas, so where no fishing is going on, and I have several plots where nets are pulled through frequently, and I'll see whether kind of human disturbance has an influence on aging patterns as well. I go to these areas. It's difficult to see here. You might see this little pole and then strings going off of that. So this is an 8 by 8 meters plot. For every square meter, I collect all kinds of ecological data on little plastic slates that I take with me underwater. Not exactly rocket science. And then I collect data that way. So just to recap, the scope of the current project is to find these correlates of age, to look at methylation patterns, first see with lab fish whether this is a tool that we can use in the first place, and then verify it in wild fish, hopefully, take measures of morphology, and then go back to these different populations and look at what the underlying ecology is. At this point, a brief thank you to all the people who make it possible that I survive in the lake and look at aging, especially Celestine Weber and Augustine Weber over here, who run the lodge where we are based through the whole time that we are there, Tanganyika Science Lodge. If you ever travel through Zambia, make sure to go there. It's a fantastic place. Very remote, very rural, but fantastic. So just a little outlook. In the long run, what I'll try to do in the field is in collaboration with people in Basel who are doing these whole genome sequences currently to identify the genes involved in broad-scale changes in lifespan. So compare the genetic architecture of long-lived and short-lived species. Try to estimate the speed at which, evolutionarily speaking, differences in lifespan have occurred in the past, whether this increase by 10 years over the last 50 years in human populations is unprecedented in evolutionary history, or whether we are not so special after all. And then what I'll do in the lab eventually is investigate the evolvability of aging, a great new buzzword that people want to throw around all the time. So basically see whether I can select certain species for shorter or longer lifespan. Then go back to the genetic correlates of these changes, and then also look at more of the ecological side of things to see whether I can identify rearing conditions or feeding schedules or whatever that lead to a healthy lifespan eventually, or extension, lifespan extension. So I hope that I've explained slightly superficially, but still lengthy. Why this should be interesting to anyone, why I'm doing what I'm doing, that I hope that this work will eventually have an influence on all of us here. Can't promise it really, but I think it's what we should all aspire to. And with that, I'm only left to say thanks to the Cambridge Philosophical Society and Hughes Hall, who gave me the opportunity to do all of these fun things. Thanks to all the people who helped me in one way or another with a project in Switzerland and around here. And thank you for your attention. And I'm open for questions and suggestions.
Thank you. thank you, Arne. It was a fantastic presentation. Could I open the floor, June?
Just something that I didn't quite get straight. So this is a very ancient lake. Mm-hmm. How long did you say did it take to cause all these speciations to happen?
So Lake Tanganyika, we have three of these African Great Lakes, Victoria, Tanganyika, and Malawi. Tanganyika is by far the oldest and is the one that has the widest taxonomical group, so to say. So humans have this out of Africa theory. For cichlids, there's the out of Tanganyika theory. So the idea is that the whole foundation for this worldwide tropical distribution of these fish comes from this lake. So in the case of Lake Tanganyika, 12 million years for these about 200 species, which are taxonomically very different. Malawi and Victoria both have been colonized probably only once by one certain type of cichlids that also exists in Tanganyika. And in that case, the idea is that it's about 20 to 40,000 years for about 800 to 1,000 different species from one colonization event.
It's just a 200 species over 12 million years. Didn't seem like so many.
No, that is true, but my argument is that I can observe greater diversity there.
Like enough.
Yeah, exactly.
Can I just ask, how stable are the lakes in terms of the environment?
That's a good question. In geological time, it's very fluctuating. Anyway, sea levels have fluctuated a lot over the last 12 million years. Certain areas that are now part of the lake have not been part of the lake before. Certain now outflows used to be influxes into the lake. So in that regards, it's quite variable. What is stable as far as the biology is concerned, over the last 40 years, where we have actually good repeated survey data, is that populations of fished species change quite rapidly with demand. Species of fish that are not of kind of culinary interest remain relatively stable. The lake is quite stratified. So below 200 meters, we have what is called prehistoric water. So water that has not been part of the general cycle of evaporation raining down and being a river or a lake again for about 10 million years, probably. It's not oxygenated, so all of higher life exists only in the top 200 meters. I don't know. Does this answer your question more or less?
Yes, I'm just wondering whether that had an impact, because we put in this the cycle, the socioeconomic of the...
So
if the environment changes, that's going to knock everything
out. Yeah, it does. And one of the big threats to Lake Tanganyika currently is the potential of oil exploitation in the area. So there is an interest to drill into these deeper layers and see whether oil could be exploited there. And then we would be up for another large-scale evolutionary experiment in real time, like with Lake Victoria.
That's going to be much volcanic activity.
So we get a lot of earthquakes because it's the African Rift, right? It's where Africa drifts apart. I'm not sure about volcanoes there. I mean, Mount Kilimanjaro is not that far away, but the area itself has not, I think, at least in recent history, had any volcanic activity, and not the lake. Yeah.
Are there any major predators of these fish?
Yeah, so one of the major predators are crocodiles in various life stages. They feed predominantly on fish. You have loads of birds, mainly kingfishers, and then the fish eat each other all the time. Yeah. So the most dangerous thing to most of these fish is a brother or a sister species that is just slightly larger. So this is part of what led to these the speciation events, is that whenever a species kind of invaded a new ecological niche, it created one by another fish being able to feed on it.
I have two questions. First thing, you said that there's crocodiles in this. Mm-hmm. I'm from Australia, and I wouldn't go into any water that has crocodiles.
Yeah, in 50 years of people going there, there have been two incidents of crocodile attacks on researchers. The local fishermen get more problems, because we have a tendency to only dive in areas where we know with certainty that there's no crocodiles, and we don't typically hang around in the shallow water, which is where the large crocodiles go for mammalian prey.
And secondly, so your long-term project, you're looking at lifespan. So what's the biggest range between the shortest lifespan and the longest lifespan?
The interesting thing is that for, now a good 100 years, people have been interested in these fish. Nobody's ever looked at that. So we simply don't know. We know anecdotes from aquarium trade breeders where they can tell us, well, this species we can breed for, decades with the same individuals. The other ones, they die pretty quickly. Okay. But it's basically the foundation for all of this has to be laid first, which is what I'm currently doing, to try and find out what really the maximum age is. So the guy we look at here, this is an about 70 centimeter long fish, very tasty. And this little cloud around him, that's his fry. So this is about 20,000 offspring that he will rear from this size to these 70 centimeters that he'll reach eventually. He'll guard them for many months, up to years probably. So this is a species that I have not currently included in my target species, just because most of them will exceed the duration of this fellowship already, but this one will probably exceed it by tenfold.
How many samples are you taking?
Of a single fish, or...
Well, I mean, were you there?
So I caught, in this last trip, there was about 6-7 weeks, I think, I caught 250 fish. So 125, approximately, in each of these populations. Yeah.
So how do you decide that's the right number to be able to observe them over time?
I just catch as long as I'm there.
Okay.
There's extrinsic factors that determine how much time I get to spend down there.
The crocodiles,
air in the tank, these are kind of the micro reasons, and then other obligations here, and nobody else being down there for so long determines when I come back. So I've not done a statistical power analysis because I have no idea what the strength of the signal will be in the first place. All of this is exploratory.
How likely do you think you are to recapture
the same fish? So the species that I worked on before, it's not on here, is one of these guys where we know from the lab that they can live more than 10 years. And I caught them for 4 years, the same individual fish. And I recognized it based on its tattoos. They have one great benefit. They are very sight faithful. So they stay with their favorite rock for most of their life. Other species that are much more mobile, recapture rates will be much lower. With this one species that I did my PhD on, about 70% recapture between years. And now I'll go half yearly, is the idea. So hopefully around that, 70 to 75% would be good.
Did I understand you correctly that the lifetime of these were determined in commercial ponds or something mm-hmm. like that. So do you expect that the biggest factor for their lifetime is going to be intrinsic? So the amount of stress and the amount of predation, the amount of disease doesn't matter? Or do you expect that the ones in the lake are going to suffer a lot more travails?
So the number one cause of death in these fish is being eaten.
Yes,
but what contributes to being eaten is partly your performance in detecting and escaping predators. Mm. And if this decays over time, as indicated in other species, in guppies, people have looked at escape times, basically from a very physiological point of view. And there you see that older fish are just not as good as escaping anymore. So while they don't die of old age, they show different rates of decay of performance over time that then lead to them suffering extrinsic mortality.
But that can't be true in the commercial ponds.
So it can't be true in the fish that we had in the lab, of which I have other anecdotal data of one species dying after 2 years, another one living for 10. whether they are just better at coping with lab conditions, as is proposed for a lot of mice strains, for example, that is something that simply we don't know currently. So, yeah.
Boredom.
Yeah, not unlikely. I mean, many of the fish are considered social in the lake because they school together and they protect each other and they'll help each other out. You put them in a tank without any extrinsic stressors, they beat each other up because all of a sudden there is nobody anymore against whom you need protection from your mate. Your mate is all of a sudden your only and biggest competitor. And so, yeah, the things we observe in the lab, to which degree we can translate them into the wild is always tricky.
Yeah, but you don't have so much competition between the different researchers in the lab, do you?
No, so this
sorry, that was a
shark. but it's not a shark tank currently. It used to be, and if you talk to people working on these fish that are a couple of years more advanced in their careers than I am, they will tell you with whom they would never talk again because of competition with your former mate.
I think I will leave it at that. Thank you.